John chapter 1. This is a part of the service we've kind of reordered and decided to go into our sermon early and save our section of praise and worship for afterward. And so hopefully you'll discover why we did that as we go along. Let me get everything set up here. It's been a joy and a pleasure to be able to preach through these first 18 verses of the Gospel of John. And so I thank Ricky and Wayne for giving me the opportunity, and their turn's coming. And I think Wayne is up next week. And,
that's great.
And so it's just really the first 18 verses as the introduction or prologue to John. It's packed with a wealth of material. We could probably spend another month preaching from it, but we won't, thank goodness. So we'll wrap up our introduction to the Gospel of John this morning. And so this morning I want to look at verses 14 through 18. And if you allow me to, I'm going to read those again for emphasis and so that they're fresh in our minds. The Apostle John writes, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness of him and cried out, saying, This was he of whom I said, He who comes after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness we have all received, and grace for grace. For the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him." Will you pray with me? Father, we come before you now, eager to hear your word.
We are eager, Father.
Eager to hear a message. Eager to learn the truth about you and your Son, Jesus Christ. And Father, eager to respond as you call us to, in obedience, in humility, as we walk in your ways. And so, Father, speak to us this morning.
Speak
out
to
of
us.
Your word.
Speak to us, Father.
Draw us together as a body, that together with one voice and with one heart, that we might praise you. In your Son's name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Imagine with me back to the first century. Can you do that this morning?
Mm-hmm.
Put on your imagining cap. Imagine with me back to the first century, after the crucifixion of Jesus around AD 30, and after the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. You're a student in a local Greek philosophy school in a major city in Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey. You're learning at the feet of a local Greek philosopher the great philosophical tenets of Thales and Socrates, Aristotle, Plato, Epicurus, and Zeno. One of the tenets that you would have learned from this philosopher is that the concept of a governing order or creator is expressed by the word logos, a divine reason which controls the natural order. Being of the Stoic philosophy, he had a different notion of logos, or reason in nature, slightly different than the Epicurean philosopher down the street. You would have learned that the Greek philosopher's concept of God, if he existed, was that God was unknowable. Even though God, if he existed at all, was unknowable, still, he would have said it would be prudent to worship an unknown God. In any event, if God existed, he would have nothing to do with matter. Concerning the idea of God, you would have learned that at the summit of existences stands the one or the good as the source of all things. He would have gone on to teach you that the soul, the copy of reason, is emanated by and contained in it. And that soul, being chained to matter, longs to escape from the bondage of the body and return to its original source. In clearer terms, the soul is good, having come from the Logos.
That's good.
But matter is not good and holds the soul in bondage until it can be freed to return to the Logos or reason or mind or the one or the good, which is the source of all things. Now imagine with me that the teaching for the day has come to an end, and you've decided to head off to the agora, or marketplace, to get some bread and wine. Upon entering the marketplace, you notice this bearded man off in a corner to one side with a group of people gathered around him. He has opened a papyrus scroll and starts to read from it. You aren't really interested, but the first words from it catch your attention.
Preacher.
In the beginning was the Logos, and the Logos was with God, and God was the Logos. This resembled some of the ideas which you learned that day in your philosophy studies about the Logos, or reason. So you move closer to the crowd to hear some more. You hear the bearded man read, and the Logos was born flesh and pitched his tent among us. And we beheld the glory of him, glory as an only begotten from a father, full of grace and truth. While you could agree with the bearded man concerning what he first read, here you would leave him, for you would never agree that the Word became flesh. This was too strange of a doctrine for your ears and your Greek philosophic mind.
That's good, preacher.
Word become flesh? Is there nothing more absurd than that? If the bearded man reading the papyrus scroll had just said that the Logos had assumed manhood or adopted the form of a body, then your Hellenistic mind, steeped in the popular dualism of the day, would have simply moved on, thinking, there's nothing new here. And yet, the Apostle John is unambiguous about what he tells us here in chapter 1 of his gospel concerning the Logos, which would have seemed foolish to the first century Hellenistic mind.
That's right.
The word Logos, which was with God at creation, who was God, was born flesh. Very simply, when the Word was born flesh, God became man. I want to share with you three things then from this first verse in verse 14 concerning the importance of the incarnation, which this simply means God becoming man or enfleshing himself. And so we're going to look at three points concerning the importance of the incarnation. J. Vernon McGee writes, he says, turn this over in your mind for a moment. Here comes God out of eternity, already the Ancient of Days. But he also came to Bethlehem, a little baby thing that made a woman cry. And notice that John's Gospel does not even mention his birth in Bethlehem. Do you know why? He's talking about the one who is too big for Bethlehem. Out of eternity, the Word became flesh. And so that's what John, the first thing that John tells us here is that the Word became flesh. The first importance is that God became man to save us. My first point is that God became man and his son Jesus Christ to save us. Now what does this mean? That God became man. Basically, it means that God chose to reveal himself in the person of Jesus the Messiah. So I already shared last week that we know that up front, don't we? We haven't got to verse 29 yet when John the Baptist says, behold the Lamb of God, but we know that up front, that what the apostle is talking about here is that God has chosen to reveal himself in the person of Jesus the Messiah. As Hebrews 1:1-2 says, in the past God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times and in various ways, but in these last days he has spoken to us through his Son. That he has spoken to us through his Son, Jesus Christ. Now what did the Son speak? What did the Son speak when he came? And I'm not just using that in the literal sense, but what did he speak figuratively? The Son spoke redemption.
That's right, preacher.
We talked about that earlier in our life group essentials about forgiveness and redemption. That's what the Son spoke. He spoke redemption. You see, without the incarnation, redemption would have been impossible.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Without the incarnation, redemption would have been impossible. Why? Why do you say that, Darren? How is that possible? You see, it would have been impossible because for God's saving act had to be in line with his character. He couldn't do anything out of his character. It had to be in line with his character. And so God could not just declare by fiat salvation. He said in the Garden of Eden, if you remember, that if you eat from the tree of life, what would happen?
You
would surely die.
That's the word, preacher.
God could not ignore his own word.
No, he couldn't.
And so death had to come when disobedience took place in the garden. And so God had to pay that somehow then the price had to be paid. And how was it going to be paid? But through God himself, the creator paid for his creation. He not only created everything, but he paid for his creation through the act of redemption. And so without the incarnation, redemption is impossible. The penalty for sin had to be paid. And only a perfection could pay it. Only one who was perfect could pay it. And so God became man in the person of Jesus Christ, who lived a sinless and perfect life, that we might have the forgiveness of sins. He died on the cross, paid the ultimate sacrifice. And so we see that it's important that when we talk about the incarnation of God becoming man, we can't fail to talk about the sinlessness of the Savior. They go hand in hand. If the Savior isn't sinless, then there isn't a perfect sacrifice.
That's right.
But so God became man in Christ to save us. C.S. Lewis put it this way: the Son of God became a man to enable men to become sons of God. That's a simple way of remembering it, isn't it? The Son of God became a man to enable men to become sons of God. So my second point then is that not only did God became man to save us, but God became man in his Son, Jesus Christ, to commune with us. Now that word commune, unfortunately, may have some different connotations in different people's minds, but think of it as commune as being in relationship with. And that's what I mean by that he came to commune with us. He says that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us.
That's good news.
And dwelt among us. That word there, dwelt among, is really more literally means he pitched his tent among us. He pitched his tent among us. Now, when you think of that image, that means, you know, if you're among people and you're pitching your tent among them, that means what? You're getting up close and personal, doesn't it?
That's right.
It means you're not at a distance. You're not outside the camp, but you're inside the camp, pitching your tent among us. Now, of course, John here is recalling imagery from the Old Testament,
uh-huh.
Isn't he?
Yeah, he is.
And now, because the word can also be translated tabernacle. And, you know, the Jews had the Feast of the Tabernacles, where they set up their booths or tents and to celebrate that feast. And so John is recalling the images of the Old Testament from Exodus. You know, and in Exodus 25, what does God tell his people? But to build a sanctuary for me, and I will dwell among them, or among you. And so they built this tabernacle, this tent of meeting, is what it came to be called, the tent of meeting. And so God told he told them to build him this sanctuary. And of course, this was before Solomon built the first temple. And you know, when Solomon built the temple, God's glory came down and dwelt there. And so God met with them. And so we get this picture, this illustration of God communing among men. He pitched his tent among us. And so here in verse 14, the Apostle John, what he's telling us is that God has chosen to dwell among his people, but no longer in the tabernacle and the tent of meeting behind the curtain of the Holy of Holies, but in a personal way. In a personal way. He has pitched his tent among us. He has come and lived as a man, suffered as a man, was tempted as a man, and died as a man, but rose again as a God-man.
Amen.
Why is this important? Why is it important that we understand that not only that God became man to save us, but that God became man to commune with us? Because, you know, the idea of commune means this intimacy, to have this intimacy, this mutual love. When you think of Jesus communing with the Father as part of the Trinity, that they're in relationship with one another. They have knowledge of one another. There's this mutual love of one another. And so why is it important for us then to point this out? Well, hopefully, if you would, turn with me over to Hebrews chapter 4. That's right before the book of James. Hebrews chapter 4, I'm going to read verses 14 through 16. This is what the writer of Hebrews tells us about Jesus. He says, "Seeing then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may attain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." You see, we have a Savior who can relate to the saved. We have a Redeemer who's been tempted as those who need redemption, and yet was without sin. The incarnation is important, so now that God just didn't just come and save us as if it was some kind of clinical thing and nothing involved, but he became man, he put on flesh, and he lived as a man. And so now when we call upon God, the great physician, we have a great physician who came into the place where the epidemic was happening.
That's right, preacher.
Who came to the place to personally share in the disease human condition, and yet was untainted by that condition. We have a suffering Savior who shares intimately in the human condition, and yet, gratefully, because he was fully God and fully man, was left unspotted by it. And so now the incarnation is important. God became man not only to save us because of our sinful condition, but also to be able to have a personal relationship with us, to commune with us. You see, God could have just saved us and said, "Okay, I've justified you, now just go." But what would have happened? What would have happened if he just did that forensic justification, just declared us righteous? But the good news is he don't just declare us righteous, he also makes us righteous. And he does that by being in a personal relationship with us, by giving us the Holy Spirit to dwell within us, so that we can commune with God on a daily basis. That's why the incarnation is important. And so if you carry that further, Jesus himself said, he had to come before the Comforter could come. And Jesus had to complete his work and leave, so what? That God could send us the Holy Spirit to dwell among us. So that's some of the second and third order effects of the incarnation of God becoming man. Third reason God became man and his Son Jesus Christ is to demonstrate his love for us. Look again at the end of verse 14, and he says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." And so not only did the Word become flesh, so that God could dwell in a personal way with his people. And also, just like in the Old Testament, when God dwelt among his people, if you remember that his glory would come down to the tabernacle. And it would say his glory would display. They call it the Shekinah glory. Maybe you've heard of that term before. You know, and that kind of described the glory of God. And yet this was nothing less than a visible manifestation of God himself when God came down. And when John here says we beheld his glory, he's telling us that the eternal Word, who is the true Shekinah glory, is the ultimate manifestation of God among men. We beheld his glory. See, John, and when John says, we beheld his glory, John's talking about him and the early disciples, the disciples with him. They're saying, while Jesus was alive, we beheld the glory of the Logos, the eternal word. When we walked with him and lived with him and saw the signs that he manifested, we beheld his glory, the visible manifestation of God himself. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father. We know, of course, that the apostle is talking about Jesus' glory as the one and only Son of God. It is glory that comes from the Father and is, in fact, the Father's glory. In fact, later in John, he says, I do nothing for myself, but only what the Father tells me. I do not take glory for myself. And so here, John is talking about the Father's glory when he's talking about we beheld his glory. You see, the Word was born and lived among men who beheld his glory. A glory, John here says, that was full of grace and truth. Now, what does the apostle mean by this, that we beheld his glory full of grace and truth? It is very possible here that the apostle John is pointing us back to Exodus. Exodus, in that passage that I read where Moses asked God, now show me your glory. God does so, and all the goodness of God passes by in front of Moses. So the two words here used by John may be his way of summoning up the goodness and graciousness of God's love displayed in the person of his Son, Jesus Christ. Just in the same way in that episode on the mountain with God passing by in front of Moses, God displayed his graciousness and goodness. And so John, in his use of the phrase grace and truth, may be talking about God's goodness, his graciousness, his love. D.A. Carson writes about it. He says, the glory revealed to Moses when the Lord passed in front of him and sounded his name, displaying that divine goodness characterized by ineffable grace and truth, was the very same glory John and his friends saw in the Word made flesh. Of course, much in the Gospel of John will show that only those who receive the Word, believe on his name, will have faith to see the glory of God in events like the Incarnation, where God became man. Much like that messianic secret in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, there's this hiddenness to the display of God's glory to only those who have eyes to see, to use a phrase of Jesus. Only to those who have eyes to see do they see the glory of God. When you look through the Gospel of John, John uses the word sign, not miracle, that this is a sign. But not everyone got the sign, did they?
No, sir.
Not everyone that was able to see the glory of God manifested in his Son, Jesus Christ. But only those who had eyes of faith, to those who received him, who believed on his name. So the Apostle Paul, that's why the Apostle says, we have seen his glory. For they had eyes of faith. This is what makes the Incarnation such an incredible act of divine self-disclosure for those who can see, but a nonsensical absurdity for those who cannot. We talked about that earlier, the logical inconsistency that some people see within the Incarnation. You see, the Incarnation displays God's character, his good and just and wise and graciousness towards humanity. This is a fact lost on most people. So God displayed his goodness and graciousness in his Son, Jesus Christ. Not everyone sees that. Not everyone sees that God demonstrated his love for us in this, that Christ died for the ungodly. Of course, to do so, the Word had to become flesh and dwell among us. But not everyone believes. Athanasius, maybe you've heard of him, he's the early church father who was the great defender of the Trinity in the Incarnation against Arianism, the hearsay that held that the Son of God was a subordinate entity to God the Father. He wrote a whole book on the Incarnation. And if you allow me, I'd like to read a little from that And so hopefully it's about a page and a half. Hopefully I don't bore you, but I think it's important to hear what the early church, and I'm not talking about the early Catholic Church, I'm talking about the early church, said about this and about the incarnation. He says this, "Now Marcarius, true lover of Christ, we must take a step further in the faith of our holy religion and consider also the words becoming man, the words becoming man, and his divine appearing in our midst. That mystery the Jews traduce, the Greeks deride, but we adore. And your own love and devotion to the word also will be the greater, because in his manhood he seems so little worth. For it is a fact that the more unbelievers pour scorn on him, so much the more does he make his Godhead evident. The things which they say, as men rule out as impossible, he plainly shows to be possible. That which they deride as unfitting, his goodness makes most fit. And things which these wiseacres laugh at as human, he, by his inherent might, declares divine. Thus, by what seems his utter poverty and weakness on the cross, he overturns the pomp and parade of idols, and quietly and hiddenly wins over the mockers and unbelievers to recognize him as God." Oh, I love that, how God turns unbelievers into believers. He goes on to say, "He has been manifested in the human body for this reason only, out of the love and goodness of his Father for the salvation of us men." You see, God became man to demonstrate his love towards us. To demonstrate his love towards us. You see, the Creator loved his creation.
Yeah, he did.
I want you to know that the incarnation was not plan B.
No, it wasn't.
It was his plan from the beginning to become man and to demonstrate his love towards his creation. To fully manifest himself in his Son, Jesus Christ. Not plan B, but his plan from the beginning. I won't read the rest, even though I really want to, but I think that gives you a flavor of what he has to say about the incarnation. So the importance of the incarnation. First, because God became man to save us. Two, God became man to commune with us. And three, God became man to demonstrate his love to us. Now, let me move on here in this passage and look at the result of the incarnation. The result of the incarnation. And in verse 15, it says, "John bore witness of him and cried out, saying, this was he of whom I said, he who comes after me is preferred before me, for he was before me." First of all, the result of the incarnation is, one, we have received new grace in Jesus Christ. We have received new grace in Jesus Christ. And actually, let me take a step back, because I didn't want to read that verse yet. Actually, let me skip over verse 15 and deal with verses 16 and 17. And I'm going to come back to verse 15 and tie it to verse 18.
Okay.
And so, verse 16 and 17. "And of his fullness we have all received, and grace for grace, for the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ." And so my first point, the result of the incarnation is, we have received new grace in Jesus Christ. You see, verse 16 here ties back to verse 14. The fullness that the apostle is talking about here is the fullness of grace and truth. The fullness of God's goodness and graciousness towards us. The fullness of the coming one who is the Word, in him is life and light. The fullness of God's glory found in his Son, Jesus Christ, the Messiah. The phrase here, grace for grace, is best translated grace instead of grace, in light of verse 17, which interprets the phrase for us. You see, in verse 17 here, he says, "The law which came through Moses was a grace from God to the Israelite people at the time of their formation into a nation and entrance into the promised land." More importantly, it served in view of what the apostle writes in his gospel to anticipate the coming of the Word who became flesh. You see, all the law and the prophets point to Jesus. The Jews are rebuked for Jesus, in fact, for not believing Moses, whom they claimed to follow, yet they would not believe that Jesus was the Messiah. You see, the law was good. The law was a grace. The law was a grace. Sometimes we don't view it that way, sometimes as we read the New Testament, because sometimes the law gets beat up, doesn't it? You know, because we think of the Pharisees and what they did to the law and stuff. But the law was a grace from God. Again, the law wasn't plan B. And so it was a grace to the Jews. And what did it serve? It served, one, to point out their need, their sinfulness and their need of a Savior. It served to point them to God. And that's why God instituted through the law the sacrifice in the temple. And so the law is good. And so here what John is saying when he says the phrase grace for grace is grace instead of grace. Instead of the grace of the law, now has come a new grace in Jesus Christ. And so while verse 17 tells us that the law was given through Moses and served its purpose as grace, now it's been replaced by a new grace that comes through Jesus Christ, in whose fullness is the gracious love of our God. And so this is what a term maybe in the Old Testament you've heard often termed as the steadfast love of God. Read through the Psalms and you'll hear that phrase, the steadfast love of God. And it talks about how his love is better than life. And so here we have new grace that comes through Jesus Christ. And the difference between the grace that comes through Jesus Christ and the grace that came from the law was that you know, Moses could be separated from the law. In fact, that's what the Jews did, and that's why they were able to claim Moses and yet not really even follow the law, because they separated it. But you can't separate Jesus Christ from his grace, from truth and grace. You see, the incarnation, the Word born flesh, God became man, replaced the law, and we have beheld his glory. Jesus Christ means that we have saw the goodness and graciousness and love of God in Jesus Christ. So when that grace that comes from Jesus Christ, is the very Jesus Christ is that's his nature. That's why you can't separate it from him. It's his very nature, that goodness and graciousness. And so now we have received the Word and become children of God. We have received a new grace in his Son, Jesus Christ. Secondly, we have received a new view of God in his Son, Jesus Christ. We have received a new view of God in his Son, Jesus Christ. Back to verse 14, John bore witness to him crying out, saying, "This was he of whom I said, he who comes after me is preferred before me, for he was before me." Here we have a testimony from the apostle that John the Baptist concretely attested to, or was a witness among the Word becoming flesh. And so, of course, we know that this verse really serves as a preparation for what follows in the rest of the prologue about John the Baptist's witness that we'll hear from Wayne on coming up. And so it's more tied to that. But here for us, the simple thing we need to understand is that the Word become flesh was concretely attested to in history. That was concretely attested to in history. And not something man-made up. You know, you hear some people say, well, we don't even know if Jesus Christ was really a historical person. That's a bunch of baloney.
It is.
That's a bunch of baloney. And so we know that not only did John the Baptist attest to him, his disciples, and we have other non-biblical sources that attest to the life of Jesus.
That's right.
And so the Word became flesh is concretely attested to. But I want to tie verse 14 to verse 18. And last week I shared with you from verse 18. Here's what I said. I said the Apostle John clearly states in verse 18 the foundational truth he has been talking about earlier in the prologue. No one has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him. It is a foundational truth, for it speaks to revelation, that act of God by which he directly communicates truth to us, truth about himself. Otherwise, we would have never known him. We would have continued in darkness, enslaved to our idols and unknown gods, worshiping the creation rather than a creator. Graciously, God has revealed himself to us in his Son, Jesus Christ, the pre-incarnate Word, the true light, the only begotten Son. Only God could reveal himself, for no one has seen God. Jesus, as the only begotten Son, is God, who has declared himself to us. Jesus is God's testimony about himself. That's what I said last week. This week, Let me dig a little bit deeper here into what John is saying in verse 18. First of all, verse 18, of course, logically follows on the heels of verse 17, and it parallels law and grace. And he says, no one has seen God at any time. This parallels the law. What did the law say? The law stated that God could not be seen by man, for to do so would bring death. God just showed Moses his glory, but still had to hide Moses in the cleft of a rock to protect him from death. The good news, the apostle says, is that the one and only, the only begotten, who is unique of, because of being born, being the Word, and being God from the beginning, has made God known. He has made the Father known. The Son has made the Father known. This phrase, that who is in the bosom of the Father, that's a phrase that represents a relationship of knowledge, intimacy, and mutual love between Jesus Christ the Son and God the Father. And so that's why later on in the Gospel, when Jesus says, when you have seen me, you have seen the Father.
That's right.
That he can say that because he has come from the Father. He has declared the Father. He has made God known in himself. The Word became flesh, dwelt among us, made known God so that we might behold his glory, the glory of the one and only, Jesus Christ. The theologian C.H. Dodd puts it this way, as Jesus gives life and is life, raises the dead and is the resurrection, gives bread and is bread, speaks truth and is the truth, so as he speaks the Word, he is the Word. You see, we have been given a new view of God in his Son, Jesus Christ. I don't mean new in the sense that we have a new God. There are some people who think that the God of the Old Testament is different from the God of the Old New Testament. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying we've been given a new view in the sense of a fresh view, a fuller view of God and his graciousness and his love. So what do we do? What do we do with all this? What do we do with the importance of the incarnation and the result of the incarnation? I only gave you 3 points about the importance of the incarnation. I'm sure if we did a whole study, we'd get a lot more, wouldn't we, Ray?
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a lot out there. I just gave you 3 points. But what do we do with this then? What is our response to what John has given us here in verses 14 through 18? That God became man to save us. That God became man to commune with us. That God became man to demonstrate his love towards us. You see, we were sinners in desperately need of a Savior. You see, the Bible says that the wages of sin is death. Death. That is what our sin has brought us. It has brought us death and separation from God. See, we would have not even known God unless God had revealed himself through his Son, Jesus Christ. And so God chose to demonstrate the love and graciousness that he has through the person of Jesus Christ, who became man, who was tempted in the same ways that we were tempted, and yet without sin, so that he could be the perfect sacrifice on the cross, that he could pay that penalty for sin, because the only penalty that could be paid was perfection, and only a perfect Savior could pay that penalty, and that perfection was found in Jesus Christ.
That's right, preacher.
And so what do we do with that? What is our response to the incarnation?
Help us, preacher.
I asked you at the beginning of the sermon to imagine with me that you were back in the first century at the feet of a local Greek philosopher. That while going to the market, you heard read from a newly written text that the Logos was born flesh. The divine had become human. God became man. Now, I want you to imagine with me that you're in the present day, an audience member in the studio of one of our modern-day philosophers. Here in this market of ideas, you hear one of her guests reading from his new book. Quote, "The messengers, Buddha, Jesus, and others, not all of them known, were humanity's early flowers." Simply, what the author is saying that Jesus was just a mortal man and a mere messenger, a teacher like Buddha, who just came to show and teach us about the divine spark within each of us and how our consciousness can escape from the bondage of the body and return to its original source. Sound familiar?
Yes, sir.
Our society, you see, has bought into a New Age philosophy, which is really an old Greek philosophy about God, matter, and man. What could be more startling to the modern mind? The Word was born flesh. The divine became human. God became man. Jesus is not just a good moral teacher, but he is the Messiah, the Son of God.
Yes, he is.
You see, there are two responses we can give
to
this idea of God become man. The first one is, we can scoff at the idea that God became man and is Jesus Christ, because we find it logically incoherent. But I want to rephrase that just a little for those of us who consider ourselves the redeemed. You see, at one point, we have scoffed at the idea that God became man.
That's right.
In society, for those who are unbelievers, then many scoff at the idea that God became man and rather believe in the idea that within them is found the divine. They just need to expand their consciousness. But you see, God became man. And they find that logically incoherent because it was fully God and fully man. Not the 100% thing. But fully God and fully man. And they can't wrap their mind around it. I don't know about you, but I can't really wrap my mind around it either. There is a mystery to the incarnation.
That's right.
There is a mystery to it. But you know, the incarnation doesn't limit God. By God becoming man, he didn't limit himself. And man cannot contain God. By becoming man, it wasn't as if all the Godhead was contained within the person of Jesus. Even though he was fully God and fully man. We can scoff at this idea. We have scoffed at this idea.
Yes, we have.
And people continue to scoff at this idea. If you would allow me to, if I can find what I did with it. Did I put it? Yeah. Okay. Let me go back to what he said about those who scoff. I like how he says it. He says, for it is a fact that the more unbelievers pour scorn on him, so much the more does he make his Godhead evident. The things which they as men roll out as impossible, he plainly shows to be possible. That which they deride as unfitting, his goodness makes most fit. And these things which these wiseacres laugh at as human, he by an inherent might declares divine. Thus by what seems his utter poverty and weakness on the cross, he overturns the pomp and parade of idols and quietly and hiddenly wins over the mockers and unbelievers to recognize him as God. I don't know about you, but I'm grateful that even though I was a scoffer at one time, that God didn't leave me there.
Amen.
That through his poverty and weakness on the cross, that he won me over. Aren't you?
I'm right here, preacher.
You see, that leads to our second response. So put it up there, Michael. Our second response is we can either scoff at the idea, or we can rejoice in the fact that God became man in his Son, Jesus Christ. We can either scoff at the idea, or we can rejoice in the fact that God became man in Jesus Christ. You see, if God didn't become man, there's no redemption.
No redemption.
If God didn't become man, we'd never know him. We'd never have a personal relationship with him. If God didn't become man, then we've never seen his love or understood it. And so we can rejoice in the fact that God became man. We ought to rejoice in the fact that God became man.
Amen.
And dwelt among us. Alistair McGrath, he's one of my favorite authors. He's a British theologian, teaches at Cambridge or Oxford, one of those well-known British schools. Besides having a doctorate in theology, he's also a scientist. And so he has a doctorate in science. But he writes this about the incarnation. What sort of things does the incarnation tell us about the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ? Perhaps most obviously, it tells us that the God whom we are dealing is no distant ruler who remains aloof from the affairs of his creatures, but one who is passionately concerned with them to the extent that he takes the initiative in coming to them. God doesn't just reveal things about himself, he reveals himself in Jesus Christ. The incarnation speaks to us of a God who acts to demonstrate his love for us, that God is love. This is a deep and important truth, but far more important is the truth that God acted to demonstrate this love. In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. Actions are, as we are continually reminded, speak louder than words. That's a good quote about what the incarnation is about. So what actions will you take today? Will you scoff? Or will you bow down? You see, if you're here today and you're not a believer, there at some point in eternity, you're still going to bow down before the King.
That's right.
Why don't you bow down now and rejoice? The choice is yours. The choice to rejoice is yours. We have a lot to praise Him for. We have a lot to thank Him for. In a moment, Wayne's going to come up and lead us in a pastoral prayer. We talked about the altar this morning. Might be a time for you to come up before He does so and to just thank God, just to rejoice. We're going to rejoice through song. That's why we're going to end with our time of praise, four songs, singing about God becoming man and finding redemption in Christ alone. It'll be a great time of praise. But you'll have this opportunity to rejoice, to come up and just pour out your heart and thank God for the redemption that He has given you through His Son, Jesus Christ. If you're here and you're not a Christian, then you have that opportunity to respond today.
That's right, today.
To bow the knee. Don't wait for eternity when you'll bow the knee anyway. But bow it now and rejoice. Wayne, why don't you come? Jimmy wants to come and just strum on your guitar. We're just going to take a few minutes. Just a few minutes for you to have this opportunity. You can do it where you're sitting. You don't have to come up. Or if you want to come up and just take a few minutes to praise God and thank Him for His Son, Jesus Christ, that He became man to save us, to commune with us, and to demonstrate His love towards us. You have this opportunity. In a few minutes, then, lead us in pastoral prayer.
Father God, we come to you today. Lord, thanking you for the incarnation. Lord, we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus. Lord, for sinners like us, undeserving creatures. But Father God, through that great word called grace, Lord, you rescued us from our sins. And Lord, I know that hearts